Welcome to our Boxing Day service here at St. Luke's Online. Also the first Sunday after Christmas. And whether you're traveling or whether you're at home having a little bit of rest after a very busy period, my prayer is that you'll sense and experience that deep rest that Jesus brings. He said, "Come to me, all who labor or are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." And so may that rest be yours this holiday season. As we come before our great God, we come trusting in Him, worshipping Him, praising Him for His perfect and beautiful attributes, His love and truth and mercy. We come before Him in prayer, and we have a prayer for this week to now share in. Let's pray. Almighty God, you have shed upon us the light of your incarnate word. May this light kindle in our hearts, shine forth in our lives through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. Well, we have opportunity for a few scripture readings, two scripture readings, before we pass over to Reverend A, who will continue our reflections. Our first reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 12 to 18. Therefore, since we have such a hope, we are very bold. We are not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face to keep the Israelites from gazing at it while the radiance was fading away. But their minds were made dull, for to this day the same veil remains when the old covenant is read. It has not been removed, because only in Christ is it taken away. Even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil covers their hearts. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory are being transformed into His likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. May God work through this reading to transform our minds, hearts, and lives.
Good morning, everyone. Good to be with you. Our second reading is from John chapter 1, beginning at verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through Him all things were made. Without Him nothing was made that has been made. In Him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testifies concerning him. He cries out, saying, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me.' From the fullness of his grace we have all received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who is at the Father's side, has made him known. And this is God's word. Well, if you caught our service yesterday morning on Christmas Day, you know we explored together from Matthew's Gospel the beautiful news that Jesus is both God and man brought together to reconcile us back to God, uniquely God and man in the same person. And this morning from John chapter 1, we'll spend some time thinking about Jesus, the glory of God, and how we are able, as mortals, to behold that glory and live in God's presence. Now, you don't have to look far in the Bible to see that God's people have always longed to have God close to them and for God to be with them. Let's look back at Exodus chapter 33. Then Moses said to him, to God, "If your presence does not go with us, do not send us up from here. How will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us?" See, Moses knew that he would be lost without God living among them. He wouldn't have the strength to lead his people without God's presence. So he begs God to go with them. And maybe you've felt something of this need to know God and to be close to him. I remember a certain point of my life where I knew I needed God. I knew I couldn't live without him, and I needed to know him more. It was a period of time where I'd moved out of home about 20 years ago. I'd moved into state for work, and I was feeling dislocated, alone. I knew that I would struggle without knowing that God knew me and was for me. And I prayed for God to show himself. And that was the beginning of a new chapter in my life of growing closer to God. Well, maybe you've had times like this. I'm sure all of us know how precious it is to know what God is like, to be able to speak with him in prayer, and to know him in the pages of the Bible and in the face of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the fulfillment of the human longing to meet God, to see God. John 1, which we've just read, verse 14 says, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us." Jesus made his dwelling with us. He moved into the neighborhood. He lived among us. The Creator became close and familiar with his creation. And this is, of course, something we need, and as Christians, we treasure the fact and celebrate it at Christmas. But even for people who don't know God, they still have this longing for connection. At one time or another, everyone has had a little taste of the beautiful and the good and the true, and they long to get closer to the source of that goodness. For example, they experience a sunset, a piece of music, some fleeting sense of euphoria in a relationship, or the adrenaline of a fast car, and they get a taste that they instinctively want to know more of that experience. And we Christians know that the source of that goodness is God, and we want to be in a place where God rules completely. Now, the German language, in fact, has a name for this feeling of longing for a place you've never been, Sehnsucht, longing for a place of total goodness and rest, a place with no fear or pain or injury. And we know deep inside of us that there is more to this world, and we long to be in that place where these longings are fulfilled. Well, Jesus came to us and began to bring in that new world of peace and healing and restored relationships. Verse 14 continues, "We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." What is Jesus' glory? He brings grace and truth. Jesus' glory is his goodness and his faithfulness. Wherever he goes, Whatever he does, we see his grace, which is the goodness of God towards us. And we also see the faithfulness of God. And that's tied to that idea of truth that we see in verse 14. What does God's faithfulness look like? Well, long ago, God promised to send a king that would bring in a reign of peace and prosperity. And God told the truth when he said he would restore the world and that he would come to live among us. When God makes a covenant with us, you know he's going to see it through. He speaks the truth and he's faithful to his promises. Well, now John compares the two covenants that God made with his people. Verse 17, "For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ." Two covenants, the old and the new, and two mediators, Moses and Jesus. Now, by the way, John's not saying that there was anything wrong with the old covenant law. The law shows God's justice. The law shows God's rightness and fairness, his unflinching holiness. He gave his people the law so that they would know how to live in a just, peaceful, God-honoring society. There was just one problem, though. They couldn't do it. They kept on breaking the laws. But God gave them the temple and the sacrifice rituals so that they could approach God for forgiveness and be forgiven and restored. Because God is holy and just, and he won't turn a blind eye to injustice. See, when someone does wrong to us, we can forgive them, but it's costly to forgive, to really forgive. If there's been a murder, we may forgive, but we still demand that a penalty be paid. If someone has stolen from us, we can forgive, but we still expect to be compensated. Everyone understands this need for justice. When we see people getting away with abuse or with genocide or polluting the earth, we long for justice. God demands this justice no less than we do. He feels the impact of it a million times more than we do. Now, this brings up a problem for us. We long to be with God, but as sinful people, we can't live in the presence of God. We wouldn't be able to tolerate his holiness. We wouldn't survive his presence. Remember when Moses asked God to be with them and to guide them in Exodus 33. Moses asks to see God's glory. And what did God say? He said, "You cannot see my face, for no one may see me and live." And so Moses had to cover his face as God passed by him. If we brought our sinful selves into God's presence without compensation, without payment, we would be destroyed. Like Moses, we want to see God face to face, but we can't tolerate it. And that's why we had to have Christmas, so that Jesus could be the temple, the place where we meet God, and he could be the sacrifice, the human representative, the payment for the ways that we'd fallen short of God's holiness. That's why he was born, so that we could have peace with God and so that we could meet God face to face. We can only see God's face because Jesus came to be one of us and to be the sacrifice that would cover all the injustice that we have done. The anger of God at injustice was poured out on the only one who lived the law so that it wouldn't be poured out on us. The law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Jesus brings grace and truth. Grace, he got what we deserve. And truth, God upheld his promise to us. He fulfilled the covenant that he made with us. Jesus came to be with us at Christmas. Now, what difference does that make? Well, from our reading from 2 Corinthians, let me remind you from verse 17, the good news. Now, the Lord is the Spirit, And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we, who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory, are being transformed into His likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. As we behold His glory, we are being changed. We're being transformed. Jesus makes God known to us. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who is at the Father's side, has made Him known. So as we close out the year, continue to marvel at the gift of God at Christmas. Thank Him for sending Jesus, so that we won't go our whole lives as orphans, estranged from our Heavenly Father, but rather we have been brought close to God because we know Him through His Son. That longing has been fulfilled and will be complete when Jesus returns and we will see God face to face. Well, let me pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank You for sending Your Son, our Saviour Jesus, at Christmas. We thank You that He is the one who brought grace and truth, that He stood in for us at the judgment and took all our sins onto Himself so that we could be reconciled and brought into Your family as Your children. And we thank You that He brought truth, that as Your perfect image, He fulfilled all of Your promises that You have made to Your people. We thank You for Your grace. We thank You for Your faithfulness. In His precious name we pray. Amen. Well, now we are going to confess our faith in God, who is Father, Son, and Spirit, as we say the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us and for our salvation He came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day He rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now we're going to continue in prayer, so would you join me in praying for the world and for the church? Let us pray for the preservation of the earth. Our Heavenly Father, we give thanks for the beauty and abundance of the earth. Give us and all peoples grace to live in harmony with Your creation. Give us wisdom and generosity in our use of its bounty. Lord, in Your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for Australia. Father, we give thanks for this land and the diversity of its peoples. Grant that we may so honour one another, that all may be enriched by our common heritage and freed from despair, poverty, and exclusion. Lord, in Your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the church. We give thanks for the good news of salvation for all people. Strengthen us for our work in the world. Empower your church to proclaim the gospel in service, word, and sacrament. Unite in the truth all who confess your name, that we may live together in love to your glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks that you are the God who brings mercy and wholeness. Comfort and heal, we pray, all who are in sorrow, need, sickness, or any other trouble. Give to those who care for them wisdom, patience and gentleness, and to us all your peace. Accept our prayers through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We continue now as we approach our opportunity to rest in God's gift of His Son Jesus as we celebrate communion. We come before the Lord's table in repentance. God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy, welcoming sinners and inviting them to the Lord's table. And so let's confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident in God's forgiveness. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we've sinned against you in thought, word and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us and strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, the good news of the gospel is that because of God's gift of His Son and that wonderful sacrifice, we are a forgiven people. That's wonderful news. And we continue to relish that forgiveness and that love as we celebrate communion now. I'll invite you just to access the bread and the wine, juice that you might have at hand, in preparation for the moment of eating them in remembrance of Christ's death. And there's some words for you in yellow. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. All glory and honor be yours, always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever-living God. We give you thanks and praise for our Saviour Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. By his death on the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Merciful God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and wine. And we pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we who eat and drink them may be partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And when he'd given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. We say together, Christ has died. Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. So we do as our Saviour has commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit, unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power are yours forever and ever. Amen. And so come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of our Lord Christ in remembrance that he died for us, and let's feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Brendan, Renee, the body and blood of Christ, keep us in eternal life. The body and blood of Christ, keep you in eternal life. And we pray together. Father, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. We're nearing the end of our time. I trust you're on our church email list and therefore have received our holiday edition newsletter, which has everything you need to know in it about what's happening over the break. For January, our services continue in our COVID safe time slots of 8:30 and 10. So we look forward to seeing you on a Sunday sometime soon. Our children's program rests over January, but of course at 10 and at 8:30 there are colouring in sheets and children are made to feel very welcome. And so my prayer is that God will bless you and bring you rest and refreshment this holiday season. And I'd like to leave you with the blessing. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. God bless and have a restful week.